Well, hello everyone. We're back again and welcome to another edition of this new show we're doing today. We're recording live from Studios B3 and I am Spencer Brinkerhoff III. Today we're going to take a break from talking about the Clone Wars and talk about the Clone Wars. No, I'm kidding. We're talking about Rebels. No, wait, that's not it. We're actually going to be talking today about Rogue One. And for this conversation today, we're going to focus all on the Rogue One junior novelization written by Matt Forbeck. And just so that we got all of our facts straight, we're actually speaking today with author Matt Forbeck. Matt, welcome to the show.
Hi, Spencer. Thanks for having me on.
You betcha. I'm thrilled to have you. Now tell me a little bit about yourself. I looked at your website. We've been Facebook friends for a little while now, but I want everybody to get to know you a little bit better as well. Now, Rogue One junior novel, is that your first Star Wars book that you worked on?
It is, actually. Oh, I did a non-licensed book called Star Wars versus Star Trek for Adams Media several years ago, but this is the first official Star Wars thing I've ever actually worked on.
That's fine. We can mix those up a little bit here. But yeah. In addition to, you know, this one being your first sort of like official foray into the world of Lucasfilm / Disney, you've also done a lot of work with Halo, Captain America, and I was actually very pleased to see that you wrote a book for Leverage, the TV show.
Yeah, I did. That was a lot of fun. A friend of mine, John Rogers, is the showrunner for that show. And I knew him from before the show took off. So I helped him set up the book deal. And then once that was all done, they asked me if I was interested in writing one of the novels.
Oh, that's awesome. That is wonderful. Now, do you spend most of your time writing books? Or tell me a little bit about what you do with game designing as well.
Well, I started out as a tabletop game designer back when I was in high school and college, even. And then moved into doing that full-time after I got out of college. Eventually, I moved into doing novels and doing video games and toy design and comic books and things like that. So nowadays, I do write a lot of novels. I write 2 or 3 or 4 novels a year. But in addition to that, I do computer game writing and comic book writing and whatever else comes my way.
Well, that's wonderful. And you are full-time freelance then?
I am. I have been for many, many years. Ever since I got out of college in 1989, I've been freelancing except for a period of time where I ran a gaming company called Pinnacle Entertainment Group, which I was a co-founder of. And we did a game called Deadlands, which did a whole bunch of different games with it, won a lot of awards. And I also worked for a year and a half as the adventure studio director of Human Head Studios, which is a computer game design company here in Madison, Wisconsin, about an hour north of where I am.
Oh, excellent.
And I did that solely for getting health insurance for while my wife was recovering from childbirth.
Yeah, you know, kids, they can put a little bit of a crimp in your style. I remember we were playing the game by Robert Kiyosaki. You know, he's the author of Rich Dad Poor Dad, and he's got a game called The Rat Race, and it was all about, you know, learning how to get out of the rat race. And in the game, it was a penalty, I believe, in the game when you had children. So,
oh yeah, I mean, they're rewarding in so many ways, but not financially.
Right.
That's not why you have kids. Obviously, they're expensive and They're much more than a hobby, obviously. But and my wife, actually, we've got one who's 17 years old right now, and the one that quit freelancing for a while and took the job for, was she was pregnant with quadruplets. Her now 14 years old.
Oh my goodness! Well, congratulations! You've got a full house all in one shot there.
We do. We got 5 kids in high school at the moment. So it's been it's a crazy year.
Wow.
But good fun still.
There's lots of running around to extracurricular activities there, aren't there?
Tremendous amount of that. I feel like a chauffeur more than a writer a lot of days.
Oh, that's awesome. Now, about the writing part of it, though, I'm curious about your daily routine. Yeah, like, Most people, they'll wake up in the morning, they get ready, they have their breakfast, and then they drive into the office and they sit in front of their computer and do their jobs, or else they're working on location doing, maintenance or mechanic work or whatever. But what kind of a daily routine do you keep when the majority of your work, from my perspective, is so creative? Is it hard to sort of like hit a stride? Is there some that days that are just slow days and you don't get anything done, and then other days you go forever?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, ideally, my ideal day starts up. The kids go off to school. I get up, get ready for the day, go sit down, start writing, and don't let up until they come home. And then I take the evening off. And then if I got more to do, then I'll start writing again after everybody's in bed. Not every day works out that way. I mean, for one, writing isn't all just about hitting a keyboard. A lot of it's about thinking about plot and character and just letting your mind wander sometimes.
Right.
And for another, some of the work I do is not just sure writing. It's a lot of it's you're doing game design or toy design or web design, that kind of stuff. Those you can't really tally that up in word count, so to speak, right? You're
Right,
just
right.
putting in the time you can. And sometimes I'll take off. Like today, I had to run an errand. I had to get my mother-in-law's oil changed. It took me an hour in the middle of the day, but it was something I could do and nobody else was available, right?
Right. Yeah.
So you kind of get that problem where people will call on you because you have the most flexible schedule in the world. But you have to be jealously guarding your time at the same time so that you don't go broke doing other people's errands for them.
Exactly. And
But
now,
most of the time it works out pretty well. So I try not to complain too much. I have a lot of wonderful people around me who help me out too when I need it, right?
yeah, of course.
Sometimes I'll travel for work. I ended up going to Shanghai, China for 3 weeks back about 2 years ago,
Really?
working for Ubisoft on some video games, and to Singapore a couple of years before that, and to Stockholm a couple of years before that. And when that happens, people always pitch in around here too. My wife does double duty. My parents come in. My in-laws come in. Brothers, sisters, whatever, steps, will come in and help out and do whatever's needed. So I'm really, it's all part of a community, and we're all helping each other out, right?
Now,
So I'm not complaining. I think it's actually a pretty wonderful thing.
no, it sounds absolutely wonderful. And being able to travel for your work and having a company like Ubisoft contact you and say, hey, we want you to come out here and work with us for a while. So, I mean, it's kind of like they're hiring you for your brain. And they're like, oh, this is the idea guy. This is the story guy. We just need him close to us so that we can, sort of like get some of bask in some of that greatness, that glow there, right?
Well, it goes both ways too. I mean, I go out there and visit so I can absorb what they're doing, right? The geniuses that they've applied already to the project, as far as they've gotten it, often they'll start without me and have an idea about how they want to go. And then they'll bring me in when they say, okay, we've got the basics of the story down, the premise at least down, and we need a story guy to come in. And I got to go out there and see, what they come up with in terms of artwork and plot and coding and what the parameters of the game are and what you're going to be doing in the game. And try to get that all dovetailed together nicely so it all feels like it's all of a piece when you're done with it, right? Like it's an intense, unique experience that's meant to be as a whole, as opposed to a lot of things that have all just been jumbled together. And that's one of the reasons I end up going on site with people like that. Often you end up going on site in the early days, and then if we can swing it later on, we'll do it in the scripting stage too. But that's often something you can do at home where you're just writing dialogue and things like that. But
Right.
for the initial cogitation, where you're sitting there and trying to come up with the greatest ideas ever and the greatest premises and the plot and everything, that is often better to be on site for, just so you can, basically spark off each other, which is a great way to do it.
Yeah. See, now cinema is a gigantic collaborative event. And in my mind, I think of, all of the people that contribute in the art department, in the design, the development, the story, the music, the special effects. And then I think about a novel and I think about a sole writer sort of like hold away, typing away at that keyboard. But it's great to hear about the collaborative process that you're involved with in these novels as well. And I think that this Rogue One Junior novelization, it may be an example. I'd like to hear more about this of this collaborative process. So one of the first questions I have about this book in particular is how did you get this job? How did it happen that they kind of went, hey, we want Matt to come in and write the Junior novelization?
That's a good question. I actually had that question myself because I have no idea, really. It came up.
Really?
I was sitting at my desk and an email came in from Jennifer Heddle. And Jen is one of the editors over at Lucasfilm, one of the top editors over there in their book department. And she said, we followed each other on Twitter for a while. I worked with a guy named Ed Schlesinger, who you're doing some Halo novels with nowadays. You've done some other stuff with. And he always spoke highly of you. Would you be interested in writing the junior novelization for Rogue One? Right. I yelled so loud, my wife upstairs in the house thought that maybe somebody had died because I was, holy shit, right? And just, I took a few moments to calm myself down and before I answered the email. But, of course, the answer was yes. But, later on, when I had a chance to talk to Jen in person, I asked her, how did you come across my name for this book? And she said, well, really, we knew you were out there, and we knew you were a guy who did young adult books or middle grade books even, and also did military science fiction. And that's not a really common crossover, right?
Right.
To have somebody who's got those kind of skills and that kind of experience. And again, because I've worked with Ed over at Simon & Schuster, he was actually my editor originally on a Guild Wars novel that I wrote for the video game there about 5 or 6, 7 years ago. It's been a while now.
Yeah.
And when they got the Halo license, I wrote Ed and said, Ed, you got the Halo license. Give me a book. And he's like, I was actually just writing you right now.
Yeah. And there are two of those that you did, right?
The first book came out, and then I have a short story that came out in Fractures, and hopefully there'll be more coming.
Okay, excellent.
Nothing I can say at the moment. Nothing's been announced.
Well, that's good. Congratulations. So then here you are thrilled about this new opportunity, and you're asking Jen about how it all came about. She lists off all of these skills, and you thought, finally.
Yeah. Hey, it all came together. What do you know?
Yeah.
I had a lot of friends who wrote Star Wars novels over the years, right? I've known Troy Denning since I was like 16 years old, maybe 13 years old. He actually kind of mentored me into doing game design when I was a kid. And I knew Aaron Alston back when he was still around and doing some great novels. And Mike Stackpole is a good friend of mine too.
Right.
So to see these guys, Paul Kemp, I've known, Bob Salvatore, right? Bunches of people who have written Star Wars novels over the years. And I always kind of thought it'd be a lot of fun to do. Chuck Wendig's another good buddy of mine who's doing the Aftermath books right now.
Right.
And I'm like, oh, man. And I'm trying to figure out how am I going to get in there. And I know some people over at Delray, but just couldn't seem to break into it. And then this one, from this angle, just from an entirely different angle, fell into my lap. And I'm like, oh, well, that's just how it works sometimes. You get out there, you try to do good work. You try to get things turned in on time. You try to make everybody happy. And hopefully word gets around that you do good work and that you can be trusted with some property. So apparently that's how it happened. I feel very fortunate because of that, because it's just as easy to skip over somebody at that point. But, Jen pulled my name out and I said, yeah, I'd be thrilled to do that.
Right. Now,
it was a kick and a half.
Oh, yeah. And here we are. So you have this opportunity to write this junior novelization. And I had mentioned earlier that cinema is such a collaborative process. I mean, you open up the book, you look at the cover, Star Wars, Rogue One, a junior novel written by Matt Forbeck. But then it says, based on the story by John Knoll and Gary Whitta and the screenplay by Chris Weitz and Tony Gilroy. So how is the process of actually writing this? Like what, I want to know like where you were in the story development versus like how much resources did you have available and how much like did you know the story and how do you adapt it from all of these other like points of view?
Right. Well, it's in many ways, this is not my story. I'm retelling somebody else's story, right? This is a story that a lot of people have worked on, and not just the writers, but the directors and the actors and the film crew as well. You know, everybody who worked in the film had a part to play in it. And I'm taking what they got there and trying to come up with a story that fits in the parameters of a junior novel.
Let me interrupt you really quick. Tell me what those parameters are really quick. What, just so before we get too far in, define a junior novel.
A junior novel is pretty much like any other novel, except it's aimed at 8 or 10 years old and up, right?
Okay.
I don't ever try to dumb down my language. I try to write very clearly. And don't try to flex my vocabulary very often. I mean, I have a college degree, but I don't need to prove it to people constantly.
Right.
So I'm much happier when I can just use simple language to convey complex concepts clearly.
Okay.
And so that for that reason, when I'm writing young adult novels or middle grade novels, I don't really dumb down the language so much as I might change the sentence structure a bit, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where I will take the sentences that might have several compound clauses and instead just use simple direct sentences that are clear for kids and for any reader, really. And
right.
The other big parameter is that it's a much shorter novel, right? So a novel like the one that Alex Fried worked on, he did the adult novelization. I believe that tips in around 90 to 100,000 words. And my novel tipped in at about 40 to 42,000 words, right?
Okay.
So you're talking about less than half the length, or about half the length
right.
Of a regular adult novel. And trying to cram everything that happens into a two and a half hour movie into 42,000 words, it can be a bit of a trick.
So. Yeah. Yeah. And so, and that's the, those are the parameters of that junior novel, but I interrupted you as you were talking about sort of like that collaborative process and writing the book and how it was sort of like bringing in these stories, you know, that was John Knoll and Gary and then the screenplay and then the differences that may be in the novel by Alexander Fried. So how does that process work in bringing all of the stories together?
Right. Well, the first thing they did when they called me about getting the novel, once we settled the contract out, they said, are you available to come out to Lucasfilm for a story conference? And I said, yes, I am. I was like, any chance to go to Lucasfilm, I'm happy to take it. You know, so,
right.
They flew me out to San Francisco and put me up in a hotel near the Presidio, which is where their offices are. And I was like a block away. And I spent, I think we had 2 or 3 days there. About 2 or 3 days. So the first day I go in and it's me and a bunch of other writers and some comic book people from Marvel who are sit down in a room. We have a little discussion. We get to see some imagery. And then they take us all to another room and give us copies of the script to read. And we have about 2 hours to read the script, maybe 3 hours, right?
Okay.
And during that time, you're allowed to take notes, but you're not allowed to bring in a camera, a phone, anything like that. And you just basically have to get as much into your head as you possibly can.
Right.
I was taking so many notes. I didn't actually finish reading the script the first time. Because sometimes when you're doing a novelization, they give you all you get are the notes. And then you have to remember every scrap of dialogue from your notes. And sometimes they don't even give you the notes. Sometimes you just have to try to remember off the top of your head what you read, you know, 2, 3, 4 months ago. And something like a novelization where there's so many great bits of dialogue and so many great lines, that's a real crime, I think, to try to miss that stuff. So
right.
I'm trying to copy all that down. And fortunately, later on, I was able to get what they call script access, which is only given out to a certain very small number of people, that you got access to the entire script and you're able to reference it whenever you want to. And they do it through a private server system.
So that's to ensure that those quotes are, you know, the same across the board. So you have access
correct.
That way. Okay.
Correct. So for instance, when we went out there and read the script out there, it was the version that Gary and John had written. And then Chris's version actually, right? Chris had come in and done the second or whatever draft after Gary and John's original draft. And then, Tony hadn't done his work on it yet. Cause this was back in March.
Okay.
And so I read through the script with everybody else. We had Beth Rivas was there and Greg Rucka and a bunch of other fantastic writers. And Beth and Greg you've probably already seen, they've announced novels for them. They're coming out soon or are already on their way. And we sat down and read the script. Then we went out, relaxed. So we got to see some dailies, which were kind of fun,
nice.
You know, which are just bits of the film that have been shot over the previous days that don't have any ADR, which is, you know, dialogue replication or replacement, don't have any sound effects, don't have any soundtrack, don't have any special effects even, right? Just little bits that show you all the actual footage that they've
right.
We got to watch about 15 minutes of that. And then they gave us a whole bunch of other visual aids that we could look at and show us what was going on. Told us who all the actors were, they were playing the various roles, so we could look them up and figure out, you know, if they tell you what somebody looks like, what Felicity Jones looks like, for instance, then you can write about what she looks like, as opposed to it's just Jyn Erso and you have no idea. It could be anybody. Right?
Exactly. Okay.
So that helped a lot. And then the book was originally due in, I think, July 15th or so. But I was about to start work on it in June. They called me up and said, don't work on this right now. We're doing reshoots. And you know, everybody knows that Tony came in then and he helped out with the reshoots with Gareth and did the did a lot of rescripting of it, or did the next draft of the script.
Now, you say you were about to start working on it, but you had already been through the script, you had some script access already, and you had your notes. You know, had things been framed up, you know, that, and then they said, stop, don't write it yet? Where were you at in your own personal progress?
Well, fortunately, process? I hadn't started yet. I was working on another now. When I got the call and they wanted me to fly out to Lucasfilm, there wasn't a whole lot of time. It was like a week, actually, between us working that out and me going out for Writers Summit. And so I had other projects I was working on. I'm like, okay, I'm going to finish these up now. And then I'll start on this junior novel. I allocated myself plenty of time to hit the deadline, right?
Right.
But and to my benefit, I've cut it pretty close a number of times. To my benefit, it usually works out that it's like, oh, something happened. Well, great. I didn't start working yet. Yeah, that's right. Fantastic. I don't feel like I wasted any time now. And I've had novels for other lines I was working on. I had Dungeons and Dragons novels canceled on me before I actually even started writing them, which was great because I got all I had to do was turn in a plot, an outline, and I got to keep my advance, and I was happy. So I would have been happier to write the novel. But, you know, at least I didn't write an entire novel, and it never got to see the light, which has happened to some people.
Yeah.
I sat down and they said, oh, no, don't start now. We're doing reshoots. We'll let you know when it's ready. And I think I got the revised script in middle of August or beginning of August. And it was beginning of August, right after I got back from a convention called Gen Con, which is the largest tabletop gaming convention in the world, which I do every year because of my tabletop gaming convention connections.
Right, right.
And I got back from that. They're like, oh, here's the script. And we need it back by – we need the manuscript then by September 12th.
Wait, so that's about a month.
So I got about a month to write the book. But, yeah, they warned me. And I knew it was coming. I knew the deadline was coming. And we agreed on that deadline, too. Like,
yeah.
Like, how much time do you need? I'm like, well, how much can you give me? because I know that they want to have the book out to be day and date with the film for the ebook, and then they're going to have the printed version come out March 28th after that.
Right.
Part of that, I believe, is because they didn't want printers or anybody in the printing process to have access to the script at all or the story at all before the movie came out.
Gotcha.
Because they didn't want to spoil it, right?
No advance, right.
Nobody sees the film, the book. You just push a button and suddenly it's on the store, right?
Yes.
Just hit the submit button. But with a printed book, obviously it goes through a lot of hands, right? All the way from the printer through the distributors, mm-hmm. through the bookstore people, et cetera. And they didn't want that getting out early. So that was one of the reasons. Alex's book would be done a little bit earlier than mine. I suspect that has to do with where they're being printed. And I don't know any of this for sure, but my guess is his is being printed in the States someplace. And my book is probably being printed in China, which means it'll take another couple months to come over and get into the stores because of that.
Right.
You know, and I used to do print buying when I was doing game publishing, so I'm a little too geeked out about that.
you know that side of the business as well.
Yeah, exactly. I understand what causes delays and why there are delays, why the time windows shift, and I try to respect that stuff when I'm writing as well, because I know that, you know, if the writer screws that up, everything else dominoes, and everybody else on the line has to pay the price. Right.
So you had about a month then to get everything wrapped up and ready for the ebook, so that it would be coming out at the same time as the film debuted. You've been through the script. You've been through sort of like the revisions. Now you knew sort of like the before and after. So tell me, when you saw the movie, did having all of this background information and being involved in the creation of the junior novel, did that, you know, spoil the experience for you at all, or what was that like?
It certainly changed it. You want to think of it in terms of spoilers. I got spoiled back in March, right?
Right, so, right.
Because I knew everything that was going to happen. I knew all the different plot twists. I knew who was going to live, who was going to die, all that kind of stuff. Who was going to be the surprise appearances, etc. So, yeah, in that sense, I had been spoiled for the film a long time before. But in another sense, it was just kind of a magical, neat way to see a film where you're like, okay, I've been working on this for months now, but I haven't seen the final cut. I haven't even seen a cut of the film at this point. And I'm really interested to see how close I got, right? If the images I had in my head are actually close to what transpires on the screen. And it turns out it was actually pretty damn close. I was really impressed. So I was very happy with the film. And I thought it moved along really well. It had some great character moments in it, just great script, and just beautiful to watch too. And the actors were fantastic. So,
Now, do you
in that sense, it was like, opening night of a play. You're like, okay, I've been working on this forever. Let's see what happens when it actually meets an audience, right?
Right, opening night of a play, but you didn't have all of that pressure.
No, exactly. Well, not for me. It's not that. If somebody hates the junior novel, we're gonna be like, eh. But if the movie tanks, there's a lot more pressure on the people who actually made the movie, right? Those are
Right.
the guys who are getting paid a lot more money than I am, of course, too. But they have a billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar franchise on their hands, and they got to do a good job with it. And I really do have to give a shout out to the people who did such a great work on that. They have the Jen Heddle was fantastic, and Sammy, my other editor there, and Mike Sigling did fantastic work. But also the Lucasfilm Story Group, right?
Oh, yeah.
Amazing group of people whose job it is to maintain continuity amongst all this stuff. But that meant that they actually read over my manuscript before it went to press, gave me feedback on it, gave me notes on it, and said, "Well, this is good here, this is wrong here, this is you couldn't possibly have known that, but this actually happens a little bit differently here," and showed me how to fix these things. And they were a fantastic resource to be able to tap into throughout that process.
Now,
And I was very grateful to them for all the feedback they gave.
and it's one of the things that I always enjoy about going back to the novelizations of these films is learning a little bit more about the characters, getting into their heads a little bit more, and seeing some hints at a broader sort of storyline, and seeing more about sort of like, maybe some secrets that were in there. Did you find that there were some secrets that you were able to talk to with the story group that you were able to hint at or allude to in your novelization?
Yeah, there were some fun bits. I mean, one of the other things is because the script was, by the time I got the final script I was working on, it was the third draft I had read. And that meant that I had to be careful not to incorporate bits from the previous scripts, right?
Right.
Because things change, right? Cassian has got a different backstory now than he did in the original draft, for instance, right? And I had to make sure, but I didn't cross over that. But at the same time, I could kind of hint at things like that. And they would tell me, well, okay, that's close. You didn't negate anything we've done. And it feeds into that pretty well. So go ahead with it, right? And then
Right.
other times you can slip neat little things in too. I had a friend, Jeff McIntosh, who's a great buddy of mine who died this year. And just before he died, it was back, I think it's September or October. And a bunch of us got together and said, Jeff, we're going to immortalize you. We're going to put your name into games and books that we're working on. Right. And so Jeff actually got as a character in the novelization. He's I think it's Tashma Jeffkin is the name we settled on that appears
Jerkin.
in the very end of the book.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's basically just rearranging the syllables of his name, obviously. But in the end of the movie, shut this off now if you don't want spoilers,
Oh
folks.
no,
But
we're full spoilers.
okay.
I should have said that at the beginning. Spoiler cast. We were just talking background stuff, but now we're talking movie. So yeah,
Right.
full on spoilers. Hit it, Matt.
So at the end of the movie, when Darth Vader comes through and he's just slaughtering all these guys, and you got that one guy who's got the data disk and he's pounding at the door and it's open just a little crack, right? And he
Right.
stuffs it through to this guy's hand, and the guy takes it and he races it over to Captain Antilles, who then hands it on to Princess Leia. The guy who takes it from that crack and moves it on, that's Tashma Jeffkin right there, right? So
Yeah.
that's my buddy Jeff. Who died of brain cancer actually earlier this year, who was a fantastic graphic designer, did a lot of wonderful things over the years, both in game design and in packaging. That's him, being part of that chain that goes from Rogue One to A New Hope,
Right.
bringing the Death Star plans and helping to destroy the Death Star. So I was very thrilled to be able to do that for him and honored to be able to give that to his parents. So as soon as I have a hard copy in my hands, I'm emailing or I'm going to mail a copy off to his mom and dad in Canada so they can have that for themselves.
That's wonderful. Great job. And I think that I saw that you once the novel had come out that you had posted that on Facebook as well as a tribute to him. Now,
Yeah, definitely.
with sort of that like inside story there, you had mentioned a little bit about Cassian and his backstory. And one of the things that I really enjoyed about the reading through the junior novelization is learning a little bit more about his thought process. There was one point that I read it and I added a note. And when I went back through, I read it again and I thought that maybe I had read it wrong. But there's a scene, you know, Cassian, his backstory. We don't know everything that's happened. We know that he's suffered quite a bit. He's lost his family. We know from the visual guide that he's gone by the name Fulcrum, which I think is really super fun to talk about as well. But the other thing that I had mentioned that I think about is there's a scene where they are on the planet and he's got his scope out and he's looking at Galen Erso, and he's about to go through with his initial mission and kill Galen. And he sees Jin has climbed up onto the platform, and there's a trooper that's walking there. And in the book, it says that that the trooper was right there, and it only took, you know, just for a second for them to notice him. But when I read it the first time, I thought, is he thinking about the possibility of having to kill Jin so that she's not captured, as he's here to do to kill her father, you know? And I think that I read that wrong the first time through, that he wasn't actually thinking about Jin. He was worried about the stormtrooper seeing him. But I mean, we do know that Cassian, you know, he doesn't want to be an assassin. I love that you added that part of the book, but he does follow orders.
Yes. No, he's not an enthusiastic killer, right? And I think that comes across in the film as much as it does in the novel. I mean, but yeah, it's ironic because, of course, there's the whole Han shoots first thing from A New Hope.
Right.
But there's Cassian just cold-bloodedly kills one of his informants, right? In the first reel of the film. Because he has to. He doesn't have much of a choice. I mean, it's either that or let this guy get captured because he can't escape with him. And then they're going to be hell to pay. And then the entire thing's gone to hell. So he has to kill this guy. And he doesn't see any other way out of it. So he grits his teeth and he does the job. But then later on when he needs to kill Galen and he balks at it, and it's actually a bit where he's showing that he's not just a machine, somebody who can actually think for himself, because honestly at this point they've already seen the Death Star destroy something, right?
Yeah.
It's already functional in a lot of ways. The chances are that killing Galen is not going to help stop that, right? And that's part of the reason he doesn't kill Galen, that and the fact that he just can't bear to do it in front of Jin as well, I think, is part of it, right?
Right.
Hopefully that comes across in the novel, and I think it came across in the film pretty well, too.
Yeah, I enjoyed that part. So it's something else that I wanted to talk about with sort of like this idea of characters and their backstory is Chirrut. I loved our blind Jedi, you know, in Rogue One. Now, at the beginning of the movie, you know, Jin's mom Lyra is telling Jin to trust in the Force. And then when we meet Chirrut, who is the guardian of the wills, right? He's there and he's protecting the temple. You know, he is the protector of the Kyber Temple and the guardian of the wills. And so we have this sort of like idea about the Force and its influence on people and its sort of like ideology as a faith. So can you give us any background information on something that may have been discussed about what it means to be a guardian of the will or a protector of the temple or, you know, a keeper of this faith?
Yeah, I think it's in that sense, it's more of a religion, not just for Jedi. It's religion for everybody, right? And they've hinted at that in previous films and such, but I think this is the first time we've actually seen non-Jedi people worshiping the Force, right? Not worshiping in the sense that you fall down on your knees and go, oh, Force, whatever, but in the sense that you have respect for it, you try to tune yourself into it. It's more of a Zen Buddhist kind of religion than a Catholic religion, I guess.
Right.
I say that as an ex-Catholic. you know, it doesn't have as much of the ceremony and pomp and circumstance. It's more about getting in tune with the world around you. And at the time that we pick up with Azen Chirrut, this is when the temple's already been invaded and is being overrun by Imperials, right? And very shortly, their entire city is going to be destroyed. And they don't know that yet. The temple, they've been basically kicked out of the temple, and they're as downtrodden as it could be. And I assume that some of these people gave up on their faith and actually joined Saw Gerrera's rebels at that point, too, to fight against
Right, probably, yeah.
The but obviously, Baze and Chirrut have not done that. And it's really Chirrut that keeps them there, that keeps them talking about it and watching over the temple and hoping they can do something. Because Baze, at that point, has lost his faith, right? He's ready to just leave this, but he believes in Chirrut, right? It's not the force itself that he cares about at this point. He cares about his old friend, who is essentially his brother that he's been with since they were very young. And to see, you know, he wanders off, according to the backstory that I know, he wanders off at some point and comes back, having lost his faith, goes off, goes to war, comes back with all the great gear that makes him the great warrior he is now. And, but still that bond with Chirrut is something he's not willing to break. That's one reason that they're so angry later on too, when, you know, they're not going to walk away from the chance to take down the Empire because they've already lost everything. They've lost their entire planet. Everybody they knew or cared about was on Jeddah, and they're all gone at this point. So that's one of the things I think that really comes across. The Chirrut is just such a fantastic. Baze is the anger, right? He's the one who's furious. Chirrut is the Zen master who's like, this is terrible and I'm heartbroken, but we're going to find a way to be in tune with this and make good things happen, right? And that bit where he goes up and pulls the lever that connects everything together, walking through the, it's just fantastic. They did such a great job of that.
Right. Now, was Chirrut always blind?
Every draft I saw, he was blinded. I can't guarantee it goes all the way back, but as far as I know, he was always the blind monk, essentially, right?
And
some archetypes from Kung Fu films and such, really, things like that. And, sure, that's where they lifted that.
Yeah, of course. And then with that, you know, I noticed that in the novelization, he wears an echo box transmitter. And I haven't gone all the way through the visual guide to confirm that, but there was the echo box transmitter sort of, it explains it in your book that it helps him sort of like get his bearings and be able to see to a certain sense. But then there's also some writing about, not in the book, but that his staff contains a sliver of kyber crystal.
I didn't know that.
I don't know if that was something that showed up online or if it was part of the visual guide. But tell me a little bit about the Echo Box transmitter, because it may be something that is part of your book that didn't make it into another. I don't know.
Yeah, I forget if I got that from the visual guide or if the story team told me that or whatever. But or if it was some other resource that was handed me. But yeah, it's actually a box that's on his belt that. It's not like Daredevil where you have radar going out, but it's like a very low level of that where it goes, it just gives off a little tick, tick, tick at a very almost subsonic level that he can hear. And then just from the echoes, kind of figure out where he is in a room or how big the room is, how many people might be into it. But of course, it's not like seeing, right? So he's still blind. And he's stumbling around. But, you know, he's one of the deftest blind people you're ever going to see because he has that kind of an aid, and he also has that kind of surety about him that comes with his faith in the Force.
Right.
But the echolocator is kind of like, in some countries, if you're walking around the streets, they actually have those tickers they have on street lamps.
Or yep, they do.
On the street signs. And not just where they say walk, 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 but they also go tick, tick, tick. So whoever's walking up to it can hear where the street sign is, the stoplight is, and figure out their location from that way. And they do a good job of that.
And every now and again, I'll hear a song that I recognize from the crosswalks in Japan, because different songs for different directions of crossing the streets.
There you go. That's the same kind of idea.
And from that writer summit and meeting with the story group, did you guys ever talk about the wills, the guardian of the wills, or the journal of the wills and its reference points?
Well, I knew about it. I knew it had been referred to. And basically, all I know is what's been said publicly so far about them being this group of people that watched over the temple, essentially, right? And that was their job, the guardians of the wills, was to watch over the temple and to when I say watch over the temple, it's different in the film because they're watching over the temple that's been invaded and destroyed, right? They would have been people who were basically servicing the temple before that, right? They would help people, penitents who were coming in, get them to their places, help them. Maybe they consult with them on various things or console them on various things, and basically just keep the faith alive, right? Which must have been fairly difficult, you would think, throughout the Empire, where it's been almost entirely extinguished at that point.
Well, that was one of their main goals.
Exactly. That's the reason it's that ancient empire or that ancient religion that they talk about in New Hope, right?
Yes.
So it's nobody else pretty much believes it at that point. The Guardians of the Wills are like the last people standing when it comes to faith in the Force. There are other people, I'm sure, around that are very quiet about it, but it's been next to extermination since Episode 3. So wouldn't be too hard to see that very many people have gone away from it. But these guys are the faithful still. Until, of course, the Empire starts kicking them out and then utterly obliterates them.
Yeah. Well, and there was one point that you had written in the book that I latched onto and made a connection, a jump to the Wills, if you will. So Chair is actually, I should have written down which section I got this out of, but the quote is, "The Force is with me and I am in the Force, and I fear nothing, for all is as the Force wills it." And I thought, yep. As the Force wills it, and they are the guardians of the wills of the Force. And I thought, right. Oh, that's a fun wordplay. You know, was that something that you were aware of as you were writing it, and or was that one of the lines that you grabbed from the script? I mean, I just thought it synced up so wonderfully. I want to give you all the credit for it.
Well, I appreciate that. I believe it was in the script, to be honest with you, but and of course, the Wills, the Guardians of the Wills, is Whills, as opposed to the Will of the Force, which is Will. But obviously there are parallels there, and they're intentional. And you know, when you're talking about the Will of the Force, of course, the Force may have its own will, but you have to be in tune with it and let it flow through you, so you can actually sync up with it and do those things. And then it becomes your will at the same time. It's this very Zen Buddhist kind of a thing going on.
Oh yeah.
So it's really neat to see him playing with that. But and I think that line got cut. I think it was in one of the earlier drafts of the script is what happened, and then it got trimmed in the final film.
Okay.
With the Force as the Force wills.
As the Force wills.
I was careful not to add too much in the way of dialogue. I mean, I did a lot of backstory and context setting, but dialogue I tried to stick to what was in the film, and especially. Yeah, especially if it was a scene in the movie, I didn't want to add something where a kid would then read it and say, "Wait a minute, that's not what they said," or "No, that's not it at all."
Oh,
or whatever.
Kids are the worst critics, aren't they? Because they don't hold back.
It's awesome, right? But yeah, they're blunt, right? They're not shy.
Now,
but, you get all sorts of reviews. I mean, my favorite reviews I get on Amazon are my 1-star reviews because these are people that somehow we just so laughably missed each other. There was no chance that we were ever going to hook up, right?
Sorry, buddy. We're just not going to be friends.
No, exactly. And, you know, the 5-star ones are like, well, these are people who already love this stuff and we're going to love it anyway.
Right.
It's the 3-star ones kind of kill me, right? Those are the ones like, oh, almost had them there and didn't quite get there.
Well, so.
But the 1-star ones, I just kind of laugh off, right?
No. Yeah. So I saw with the Rogue One book that there was a 1-star review because the book was initially listed as a picture book. And
exactly. And
so they gave a 1-star, and I was sure to counteract that one with a 5. So I beat him down.
I appreciate that. I get that stuff. Like I wrote the Marvel Encyclopedia a few years ago too. And I did 2 editions. And the last edition was 2014. And I get reviews for that. They're often like, oh, fantastic. It's like 90% of them are 5-star reviews. But the 1-star reviews are things like showed up damaged.
Yeah, that has nothing to do
so
with your authoring.
Beyond my ability to control, buddy.
Right. Now, as you were putting things together and you said that you were trying to stay close to those lines so that you can avoid some of those 1-star reviews, I'm sure that was your motivation. You also mentioned that you were able to focus a little bit more on the characters and their backstory. One of the things that I also picked up on here is Bodhi. You know, Bodhi Rook, one line at the beginning of the chapter says, Bodhi had planned his escape for weeks. And I started thinking, for weeks, what happens? You know, what was he doing in this escape? How did he initially get this idea? Why did he think that he could defect? And then later on in the book, it said that Galen Erso had actually approached Bodhi about betraying the Empire. And that was that section I actually did note was in chapter 56. So tell me about that. You know, tell me about Galen approaching, you know, Bodhi about Galen's master plan of, you know, putting a fuse at the center of, you know, the Death Star machine.
Yeah, I mean, there's a great untold story there. I don't know all the particulars about it because I don't think anybody's actually set it down. But Bodhi is, you know, a guy from Jedha. Actually, he's a local boy, as Saw Gerrera says in the film, right?
Right.
And he sees that the Empire has invaded his home planet, his home city. And he doesn't know they're going to destroy it at that point, but he probably suspects that some bad things are coming. And he's got to get right with himself, as I think Bae says at one point in the film to him. He's been working for the Empire, but he's just, you know, gobsmacked. He's gut cut about how these horrible things that he's involved in, right. And he can't bear it anymore. So he has to figure out a way to do something about it. But I assume what happens at this point is that Galen spots him on a service mission in and out of Edu, where he's bringing Shuttle One in or whatever, and says, okay, this is a young man that I might be able to trust to get this message out of here for me, right? Because Galen's not able to get it out himself. So he needs to find somebody he can trust that he can give this to that won't just get caught and destroyed. So how Bodhi actually managed to convince or appear to Galen that he might be something like that, I don't know for sure. Maybe he was caught cursing the Empire at one point. And Galen said, hey, kid, you really don't like the Empire? I got something for you, you know? But there's some kind of a cool backstory there going on. That's just kind of how I envisioned it.
Yeah.
And then, of course, once Bodhi knows that Galen's going to give him the information, he has to figure out, how do I get this out of here without getting caught with it, right? How do I get it to Saw Gerrera? If I just grab something and fly back to Jedha, somebody's going to know and they're going to shoot me down. Maybe I have to wait until I have a shuttle run taking me to Jedha. Maybe I have to put in for a shuttle run to take me to Jedha. Maybe I have to put in for family time. Who the hell knows, right? go back and see my parents, right? And that's how he actually gets to Jedha. And that's, you know, and then when he tries to find Saw, they capture him and torture him, of course,
because
they're good, fun people.
Well, and even in the end, you know, his sort of like battle cry, Bodhi says, "This is for you, Galen." You know,
yeah.
And so, I mean, there was obviously a connection there that we didn't get to see develop, but that, and that's the other thing about these books is that they give another level of depth to all of these wonderful characters that we met in the movie and then lost.
Exactly.
As soon as we met them, they were all gone.
As they say in the role-playing game industry, is a total party kill, right?
Yes. It's just,
I felt bad for them all. But, you know, once they start dying, you're like, well, yeah, it fits. It fits perfectly, right? It's a true statement on war. It's war,
right?
Is a price. It kills lots of people, and their prices are paid. And if they're paid willingly and well, then it's not such a bad, horrible thing. You wish none of them had to die. But they're doing this willingly, and they're doing it for a cause they believe in. And in the end, it turns out for the right. I think that's a wonderful. So that's what makes it a heroic story as opposed to a tragedy.
Exactly.
Even though they all die at the end, it's still not tragic that they die.
Right.
It's part of that chain of hope that they're going.
Well said. And in sort of like a closing topic that I wanted to cover, you mentioned that Bodhi, you know, had gotten the information from Galen Erso. He somehow got himself away. He got himself to Jedha where he could track down and find Saw Gerrera. Now, Saw originally showed up in the Clone Wars. We got to see sort of his beginning there. And then in Rogue One, we got to see his end. And we've seen some teases about him showing up in the Star Wars Rebels, you know, coming up in their mid-season premiere. It's a two-parter called The Ghosts of Geonosis. So Saw Gerrera has been causing lots of problems for the rebellion, so much so that he wasn't sure if the rebels or the Empire were out to kill him when Bodhi shows up. So tell us a little bit more about Saw and his character.
You know, Saw evolved a little bit during the script as well. I mean, people may have noticed that in the different trailers, he looked different. He had lines that didn't show up in the film, for instance.
Right.
And essentially, the final version of Saw that we get is a guy who's just been shattered and is utterly paranoid about everything at this point, right? He's nearly been killed by the Empire, or maybe even by the rebels at this point. He's got this hideout where if anybody gets anywhere near it, he assumes they're trying to kill him, which is the reason that he treats Bodhi so badly, right? And right. Here's Bodhi, who's got no reason to lie. Why doesn't he just read the damn data disk and figure out what's going on?
Oh, and
you know, watch the hologram.
And I enjoyed that hideout was the holy quarters of the temple. That was good to know too. So yeah, he's hiding out. He doesn't know if Bodhi's there to kill him or not.
Right. I mean, he even gets paranoid when Jen shows up. He's like, "Oh my God, Jen!" And then he's overjoyed to see her. But then he wonders, "Did she come to kill him?"
Right. Right. You know? Right.
Is this the end? How bitter that the one of the few people I care about in the world or in the universe is here to kill me, maybe.
Right.
And it's not until the very end that I think he actually believes that she's trying to save him, that she really didn't have it in for him, that she did care about him, and he maybe did her some wrong in the past. So it's a very complex emotional system for both of them, I think, at that point. But especially for Saw, it's just, I think part of it's just that he's, obviously, he's missing limbs. His lungs have been destroyed.
Yes.
Just not in a good way at that point.
Right.
And if anybody has a right to be paranoid at that point, it's probably Saw. I mean, it's probably not unwarranted paranoia.
Something about that, his condition, that broken man, you know, there's something very Vader about, you know, him in those scenes.
Very much so. He's almost like a mirror image of Vader. I mean, he's working for the rebellion as opposed for the Emperor. But this is a guy who, you know, has to breathe through a mask, who's missing limbs, who's given everything but his life for this cause that he believes in, and is prepared to give his life too, and will, right?
Right.
And Vader in the same way. I mean, he's prepared to give his life, and in the end gives his life, of course, for his son as opposed to for the Emperor, which is this great redemption that he does.
Yeah.
Yeah, Saw is just another a riff, I guess, on Vader. I think, and a pretty interesting one to watch happen as well.
Right. Now, I had another question about Saw. I noticed that in chapter 18, you know, Saw and Jin, they're watching the hologram message from Galen, and he tells them all about the trap that's been laid inside of the Death Star. Now, before the movie came out, there was a couple, and then books. There was a couple of people online that started to say, "Hey, I think that Rogue One is going to fix this major sort of like plot hole in A New Hope," and they started to guess that it was, you know, Galen Erso who had laid the groundwork for the destruction of the Death Star. Well, what is your impression when you see some of these online reports that go, "Oh, they got it right"? Do you think, what do you think when you see that?
I think that's awesome. you know, I don't think it's, you know, the people who are working on this are very smart people, but we're not super geniuses, right? We're not.
You were at a writer's summit. That sounds like super geniuses to me.
Well, you know, we're clever people, but we're not Albert Einstein. We're just basically making up stories, right?
Right.
And stories, ideas are going to be things that have occurred to other people. It's inevitable that this kind of thing happens, especially when you think about the size of a Star Wars fan base, right?
Right.
Think about how many people are guessing at what's going to be at this. There's got to be at least a tiny percentage of them are right. Let's say it's 0.1%, right? Mm. Even that's got to be like 1,000 people.
So, right. Right. That's true. That's true.
You know, so at that point, I'm not surprised that somebody came up with it. I'm just surprised it was a lot more people. and I'm happy that it was something that made people happy at the end of the day where they said, "Oh, that's cool. It fills this up," or whatever.
Yeah.
But, you know, again, when you're talking about something that's just reached out to so many millions of people like this, it doesn't take – somebody's going to be right about this. Somebody's going to have guessed it. It's like the old thing about you put a million monkeys in or an infinite number of monkeys for an infinite amount of time, and you get somebody who writes Shakespeare, right? Eventually, somebody's going to guess at these things just because there's so many people guessing them. And good to them. I saw on Twitter somebody pointed out like that. They said, "Hey, you actually guessed this back in October. I just want to call that out to you now." He's like, "Yeah, I didn't ruin it." And, you know, he should get the Marvel No Prize that Stan Lee used to give out, right?
Yes, yes, that would be awesome.
All the kudos in the world to him for figuring that stuff out. That's pretty cool. But I'm not surprised that somebody figured it out. It was pretty inevitable.
Well, and another point about the book that I really wanted to say that I enjoyed. I know that, you know, not all of the lines were yours. So when we get these descriptions, I think that's you. Vader. Yeah. When Krennic is there with Vader, it says his breathing sounded like he was just this side of the grave and meant to suck everyone else down with him. Oh my gosh. Well done, Matt.
Thank you. I love it. It's like, you know, you're like a kid. I'm like, I get to write Darth Vader into a scene. How cool is that?
Exactly. Exactly. Now, in closing, then I want you to tell everybody where they can follow you, where they can find out more about what you're doing. And do you have any other favorite pieces or parts of this experience that that you want to share with us?
Let me see. If you want to follow me, the easiest places to go are to go to Forbeck.com. That's Forbeck.com. I'm also on Twitter at M Forbeck. And I'm on Facebook. You can find me there. I'm on G+. I'm on all the other services, mostly on Twitter and on Facebook. And you can always reach me through my website. And what are the other great experiences about this? I think, honestly, going down to Lucasfilm and being able to visit the offices, you know, hang out with the guys there, meet Gary, meet Jen, meet all the editors, meet all the other fantastic writers, and, you know, wander around and see all the stuff in ILM was just stunningly cool and fun. And I hope I get to repeat that experience because it was one of those things where I'm like, oh, man, I can't believe I get to do this. It's just neat. And now I can't tell anybody about it for 9 months. That hurt.
Oh, the price that you have to pay.
God, I was biting my tongue. I was at Comic-Con, and I couldn't tell anybody. I was like, ah.
Oh, man.
And eventually, Mike Sigling, who was the head of that department, said to me, I wrote to me before Gen Con, so you can tell people, as long as you don't tell it on the internet, just go ahead and tell people. You can maybe mention it at a panel, tell your friends, whatever. I'm like, oh, thank God.
Excellent. Oh, wow. Excellent. So the internet makes things more real, I guess.
It does make it feel more real. But at a certain level, it feels like you're walking through a dream. Like, you know, if my 10-year-old self would be just tickled pink to see the kind of stuff I get to work on these
right.
things.
Well, Matt, thank you. You've done a wonderful job. I appreciate you taking the time out of your busy schedule and household duties of fixing the toilet to come in and chat with me today. I really enjoyed the book. I enjoyed being able to relive the story of Star Wars Rogue One through your writing, through your experience in collaboration with all of these other writers and stories and screenplays in the story group and the writer summit. It was fantastic. If you guys if you guys like and anybody listening out there, if you have any questions, be sure and reach out to Matt. He's more than willing to chat with you online. Probably not going to argue with you about too many things because he's a good guy. Nope. And if you wanted to hear some more about what we've got going on here, you can listen more on this channel. You can find me. I'm Spencer Brinkerhoff III. You can see me at Facebook.com/SpencerB3 or on Instagram or on Twitter, all the same. And stay tuned. I enjoy being able to have the opportunity to speak with all of these wonderful creators, and I'm going to keep on doing it. Thank you very much for talking with me today, Matt.
Anytime, Spencer. Thank you much.
All right. Talk to you all soon. Goodbye, everybody.